afternoon. It's such a pleasure to welcome all of you to the Supreme Court this afternoon to participate in the ceremony honoring a change in leadership. I'd like to welcome, it will be a mistake for me to start with specific names because there are too many here for me to introduce it, but I would like to specifically welcome the members of our Court of Appeals, a large number of state and federal judges who are here, and to also recognize two former Chief Justices of the Utah Supreme Court, Richard Howe and Michael Zimmerman are here, and Leonard Russing, a former member of the court who's joined us. It's wonderful to have you with us. I would also like to announce that the governor and the lieutenant governor have notified the court that although they would like to be here, other commitments prevented them from coming, but they asked me specifically to mention that they send their regards and their regrets. The ceremony today will begin with remarks. I will give the first set of remarks, and then we will ask Judge Dale Kimball, a former partner and colleague, soon to be the new Chief Justice Matthew Durrant, to speak, and following him, Robert S. Clark from Justice Durrant's old law firm, Harper and Giannopoulos, will also make remarks. There are those who think that a certain law firm, whose name I just mentioned, has something of a lock on judicial appointments. Given that three members of the current court, including Justice Durrant, and a number of members of the federal bench have come from that law firm, I think it's appropriate that they should be represented on the program here today. Justice Durrant asked me if I might spend a few moments in my remarks talking about the role of the Chief Justice in Utah's judicial branch. The Chief Justice in Utah has a number of hats. The first, of course, is that he or she serves as the presiding officer of the court and presides over our conferences and over our oral arguments. That's relatively light duty, however, compared to the other assignments with which the Constitution vests the Chief Justice. In Utah, the Chief Justice is the constitutional head of the judicial branch by virtue of being chair of the Utah Judicial Council, which is the governing entity and the policy-making body for Utah's courts. Thus, the Chief Justice serves essentially as the CEO and the Judicial Council as the board of directors for Utah's judicial branch. The Chief also serves as the spokesperson to the other branches of government, to the public, and to our internal constituency, the courts and the court's judges and their staff throughout the system. So in that capacity, the Chief Justice has a great deal of administrative responsibility and authority. The Chief is responsible for proposing policy and directions in partnership with the State Board Administrator for the branch of government, responsible for bringing ideas, challenges, and information to the Judicial Council, and then, perhaps most importantly, responsible for articulating, explaining, defending, and encouraging the implementation of the policy decisions that the Council undertakes. It's quite clear, I think, and I certainly hope to everybody here in this audience, that courts are an integral part of state government. Without fair, impartial, and efficient courts, government could not fulfill its constitutional obligation to sustain, protect, and defend the rule of law. Our system in Utah is designed to ensure smooth transitions in leadership, and this particular transition is no exception in that regard. Justice Durrant has already begun attending Judicial Council meetings, management committee meetings. He, of course, has undertaken many positions of responsibility and leadership in the committee work of the court and of the system, so he's as ready as one can be before knowing where all the bodies are buried to step into the position of leadership. When I announced the fact that I was stepping down to the legislature, I commented that the members of this court had unanimously asked Justice Durrant to become the new Chief Justice, and I told them that he's someone who has great intellect, great ability and skill, and a great sense of humor. I rather suspect that it's the last characteristic and set most effectively in his new position. He'll need a sense of humor. And he'll need the support and assistance of so many of you in this room, people who have experience, who have influence, who have knowledge about our system and about the responsibilities that the head of the system has to meet. And I'm sure he will look forward to relying on that support as he undertakes these responsibilities. He has the respect of his colleagues on the Supreme Court. He has the respect of his colleagues throughout the court system. And he has the respect of the bar. I think he's extremely well suited to undertake these responsibilities. I would also be remiss, and I'm sure he would call me on it, if I did not let you know, in case any of you were unaware, that he, and I'll have to offer apologies to some president of the courtroom, but he wishes to be known as the handsomest Chief Justice. Congratulations, Matt. Judge Kimball.
It's been my observation in life that wishing to be known as something and actually being known as something are two remarkably different things. Chief Justice Durham and members of the Utah Supreme Court, Presiding Judge McHugh and members of the Utah Court of Appeals, and all other distinguished that I had spoken at the time that he was made a district judge, and at the time he had been elevated to the Utah Supreme Court. I made it clear that much of what I would say had been included in my two prior speeches. He indicated that that would be no problem because he was not acquainted with anyone who had attended one or both of the prior speeches, who cared enough or who was intelligent enough to remember anything that I had said. He also pointed out that he didn't know anyone who could prevaricate about him so profusely and so happily as I. So I proceed with the full knowledge of all that these types of speeches are a kind of an advance funeral speech ahead of the actual one. It occurs to me that I probably ought to consider how nice I ought to be to the members of the Utah Supreme Court. As many of you know, in federal court, sometimes we apply state law, which is often Utah law. When there is no Utah law or Utah law is unclear, federal judges will certify the question of state law to the Utah Supreme Court for determination on the point. However, on many occasions, we believe that the law is relatively clear or the trends are clear, and we decide the question without certifying it. In the last few years, however, the Tenth Circuit has certified to the Utah Supreme Court more of those kinds of questions when the case is on appeal and the district court has already ruled. If I currently have some of my cases with certified questions of state law in the hands of this court, perhaps I should be more temperate in my comments. Perhaps I should, but I probably will not. Matt faced early challenges and had early character-building experience. His parents lived in Louisville, Kentucky, during at least part of the time he was in high school. Matt was the minority member of his high school basketball team. I note that the University of Louisville has a team in the Final Four. That suggests that the quality of basketball in that area has been greatly elevated since he was playing there. During his undergraduate years at BYU, he decided to serve his church for 2 years. According to a graduation speech Matt gave later on April 24, 1981, he went to his father with a concern. "Dad," he said, "I'm not sure that I can go for 2 years without a date." His father thought for a moment and gently said, "Son, you've gone the last 2 years without one." "I found," Matt said, "that a difficult argument to counter." Matt absorbed well these early lessons in logic. Matt is the co-author with his father of two short novels. One is entitled Upset at Rooster Creek, and the other, There's an Enemy Sub in Potter's Pond. The second of these begins with the provocative sentence, I reckon going to Saratoga Swimming Resort is better than going to heaven, on account of you got to die to get to heaven, but you only have to take the bus to get to Saratoga. This has particular resonance for me because growing up in Draper, I fondly recall going to Saratoga on a regular basis. Matt graduated from Brigham Young University in 1981 and from the Harvard Law School in 1984. He clerked for our firm during the summers of 1982 and 1983 and also did some long-distance work for us during his third year of law school. After a year clerking for Judge Monroe McKay of the Tenth Circuit, he joined our firm full-time in 1985, where he worked until June of 1997, the end of June. He was then appointed to the Utah District Court by Governor Leavitt, and in early 2000 was appointed by Governor Leavitt to the Utah Supreme Court. Many of us at the firm were privileged to watch him to develop into a mature, capable lawyer. One might say a model lawyer. When I say model, I do not mean a small replica of the real thing. I have in mind the definition of model as a person to be imitated or patterned after. He was a gifted and a good person. He is diligent and hardworking. He is reliable and responsible. He became a dedicated and an able trial lawyer. As a lawyer, he occasionally became embroiled in the inevitable difficulties, tensions, and battles that are part of the litigation process. However, unlike some in the profession, he never let these problems become personal. He focused on the problems and on the issues and on the solutions. Matt solves problems rather than creates them. He has penetrating judgment. He is calm and fair and intelligent. He is thoughtful and he is caring. He is sensible and he is unselfish. He is a team player. He is not self-important. Matt is one of the best people I have ever known. He looks for the good in people. There is not a mean bone in his body. He is not a whiner. Arguably, get this, arguably, one of his greatest weaknesses is that it is almost impossible to get him to criticize anybody about anything. Perhaps this is a weakness that we should all seek to emulate. From all that I know and hear, Judge Durrant was a superb district judge, and Justice Durrant has been an excellent Supreme Court justice. He has always been able, fair, and hardworking. He is intelligent and reasonable, and he writes well. He understands how court decisions impact litigants and lawyers in real life. One of my colleagues once mentioned that appellate courts are only right because they are last. Be that as it may, it is a critical part of the legal process that appellate courts, in a reflective and deliberative manner, are available to litigants and lawyers and do their work well and with intelligence and care. Matt exemplifies all of these qualities. He also cares about people. I quote once more from that April 24, 1981 graduation speech, quote, as my education deepened my compassion for those who are hungry, naked or without hope, or provided a conscience-soothing salve, a handy list of reasons why they deserve their lot, has it brought a sensitivity unbounded by cultural, social, or national differences, or merely furnished comfortable justification for my provinciality. In his new job as Chief Justice, Matt gets to keep all of his existing responsibilities and add considerably to them. He will feel the joy of a lot of extra work for little extra pay. He will now basically administer the entire state court system. He has to worry about budgets and the state judicial council and the administration of justice for everyone in Utah with respect to the state courts. I know that he has thought about this. I'm also convinced that he does not undertake anything that he will not complete. He does not understand halfway commitments. He will do the best he can, which is considerable. I predict he will be a great Chief Justice. Thank you.
Chief Justice Durham, members of the Utah Supreme Court, distinguished members of the Utah Court of Appeals, and other honored guests, it's a privilege to be part of this momentous and historic occasion. Justice Durrant's Utah roots run deep. Both of his parents were born and raised in Utah, and their generations before that have Utah connections. That's a connection that provides a deep loyalty for him and a deep connection to this state, its people, and its heritage. He was, however, not born here. He was born in Arkansas, near Fort Chaffee, where his father was serving at the time in the military. And because of that, when Matt was born, the medical bills totaled $7. And when his father would mention that, his mother would quickly say, "And he was worth every penny." George and Marilyn Durrant were world-class parents. They have raised a wonderful son in Matt and wonderful other siblings. He has been anchored to his family, both his parents and siblings, and now the family that he and the beautiful Jacqueline Hewish have formed, that have now six children and grandchildren in addition to that. Matt's parents have been known to say that Matt was nothing until he met Jackie, and there are many who would agree with that. Even with all of his Utah ties, Matt's life has been enriched as he has experienced other cultures and experiences, including, as was mentioned, high school in Louisville, Kentucky, at Seneca High School. And despite his being sort of a foreigner to that region, he became very popular among those individuals. He served as the student body president there, and in addition to being a successful member of the basketball team, and despite what Judge Kimball may think, Kentucky has had a long tradition of excellent basketball. But the fact is that Justice Durrant has always had a delightful sense of humor, been amazingly bright. As a lawyer, he was always reliable, diligent, bright, exercised good judgment. He had this delightful sense of humor. He would occasionally draw people in and request that there would be a debate over very superficial things that happened to be just sort of the vogue of the day. And he would moderate debates such as, are certain Olympic winter sports truly athletic events? And whatever you might think about that, he was adept at playing the two sides off of each other, and it was a delightful time. In addition to that, one of the great memories I have of his practice with us was his deep commitment to ethics and to character and to the kinds of things that really matter. I remember on one occasion we were approached by a very large out-of-state firm with what appeared to be a wonderful opportunity to represent them. We were one of several firms. This was not a situation where this was a company that was unable to obtain representation. Many firms were competing for this. And I remember, though, that as we talked about it, there was a discussion about the fact that the industry that this company was involved in was not something that many of us really wanted to be part of. And as we discussed that, we were many discussing the financial opportunity and others concerned about what it would mean as to what we really wanted to do. I remember in a very wise and profound way how he spoke with wisdom beyond his years of talking about how important it was to him to always be able to be centered morally in the things that we were doing. And his point of view prevailed. We were grateful for his perspectives at that time and appreciated them very much. He always maintained his perspective, never exaggerated or did anything that would cause one to question his basic ethical background. I should point out as well that Matt and his family are no strangers to challenges and difficulties in life. Many of those are very private and real, but I believe it was Abigail Adams who said that affliction is a good man's shining time, and later wrote in a letter to her son, "These are the times in which a genius would wish to live. It is not in the still calm of life that great characters are formed. The habits of a vigorous mind are formed in contending with difficulties. Great necessities call out great virtues. When the mind is animated by scenes that engage the heart, those qualities that would otherwise lay dormant wake into life and form the character and the statesman." Matt Durrant has faced challenges and overcome them and been a shining example of the kind of character that we would all want to have at the head of our judiciary. Judging, of course, requires someone who is honest, wise, fair, and centered on the law and the Constitution. That is the kind of person that Matt Durrant is. Indeed, the rule of law is so critical in our society, and his example and leadership have always been centered in that way. The role of the judiciary is not only to decide cases, but to be perhaps within our state the symbol of the rule of law. In 1952, Dr. Martin Luther King spoke at Vanderbilt University, and in that speech he talked about and drew a distinction between obligations of the law that are enforceable and those that are unenforceable. And this is what he said. The enforceable are regulated by the codes of society and the vigorous implementation of law enforcement agencies. Breaking these obligations, spelled out on thousands of pages in law books, has filled numerous prisons. But unenforceable obligations are beyond the reach of the laws of society. They concern inner attitudes, genuine person-to-person regulations, and expressions of compassion which law books cannot regulate and jails cannot rectify. Such obligations are met by one's commitment to an inner law written upon the heart. It is a great honor to recommend to you as our new Chief Justice, Matthew B. Durrant, who does have an inner law written upon his heart and who is an example and will be a great credit to our state and to this bench. Thank you.
And Rob. few good qualities and ignore my many bad ones. The timing on this is good too, because my self-image took a bit of a blow a number of weeks ago when it was announced that I would become the new Chief Justice. I hurried home from work that day, eager to see how this news would be treated by television news stations. I flipped from one to the other. I watched the first half hour, and I have a second half hour. I watched the second half hour, and not a word was mentioned. Of course, it was a big news day. There had been a Shih Tzu puppy stolen from the pet store in Orem. They had security camera footage, interviewing the pet store owner and so forth. So it was good to be reminded that maybe I'm not as important as sometimes I start to think I am. I would like to begin by paying tribute to Chief Justice Durrant. She has been a leader of vision and remarkable commitment. To me, she has been a great inspiration. She has been a great inspiration to many, many others. It is an honor for me to serve with her. And I would simply like to thank her for her truly extraordinary service. At times, I wish it hadn't been so extraordinary, like right now, because it makes it all the more daunting a task to follow in her footsteps. I do feel rather inadequate right now, but I take great comfort and confidence from the fact that as Christine mentioned, I have so many talented and dedicated people to help me in this new role. That would begin with my colleagues on this court. For me, my job is a daily joy, in large part because of my colleagues on this bench. They are, each one of them, gifted jurists. Good people. I have never seen one of them unprepared for an argument. I have never seen one of them make a decision on anything except a principled basis. And it is a great honor to serve with them, and I wish to thank them for the confidence that they have shown in me by electing me to this position. I also draw comfort from the fact that there are so many talented judges to help me through this process. Our judiciary is of an extremely high caliber, and that's not just my bias speaking. That is a function of the way in which we pick our judges in this state. Rather than, as is the case in some states, picking judges through who is the best fundraiser or campaigner or politician, here in Utah we employ what is called a merit system. And I'd like to describe it just briefly. In our system, the governor appoints a bipartisan panel. That is, panel is composed of lawyers and lay people. They receive applications for judgeships. And survey forms or grading forms are sent out to judges before whom the candidate has appeared, to lawyers with whom that candidate has practiced or even opposed in cases. And these reviewers are asked to score the candidate in a number of categories, everything from character to intellect to on this information, based on the resumes and interviews with the different candidates, a certain number of names are forwarded to the governor. And from that name, he, with the assistance of the lieutenant governor, picks one. So the net result of this process is that unless someone has distinguished himself or herself professionally, that person will not be appointed to a judgeship. And this is, so these are the kinds of people I get to work with and whose assistance I look forward to receiving. I also take comfort from the fact that we have a superb administrative office of the courts. That is the office that assists judges in performing their roles. It's full of talented people. I look forward to help from them, from other employees throughout our state judicial system. Our AOC, I know, is a national model and at the very cutting edge of many issues of judicial administration. So, that's enough bragging about our judges and the employees in our state judiciary. I'd like to take a minute and brag about my family. I have the good fortune of being married to the best person I've ever known, and the even better fortune to still be in love with that person after 32 years of marriage. This is my wife, Jackie. This challenge is a daunting one for me. It's also a thrilling one. it's a sacred charge to be a judge. People come to court at some of the most critical junctures in their lives. Their fortune, their future, even sometimes their freedom is at stake. And they deserve a place where their decisions can be made about their lives uninfluenced by wealth or status, race, gender, or any consideration other than the law and the facts. And I know that the judges of our state are committed to providing those places. And that is my commitment. It is a deep honor to serve our judges, and a deep honor to serve the citizens of Utah. Thank you.
On behalf of the court and the new Chief Justice, I'd like to thank you all for attending today and invite you to join us in the rotunda.